Foam roller is a tool used by people to apply self-massage. Thus, it's a form of manual therapy, which is also known as self-myofascial release. Today, foam rollers are more common than ever inside the gyms, and more athletes use these tools to take a swing at treating their own pain and dysfunction. But do they actually work? On the major benefits, foam roller is supposed to improve joint range of motion, reduce muscle soreness and improve tissue recovery, and enhance athletic performance. So let's see if these claims are being supported by science, starting from the idea that foam roller improves joint range of motion, which seems to be supported by a 2018 study where scientists investigated the acute effects of foam rolling and rolling massage of anterior thigh on hip range of motion. And by hip range of motion, in this case, we mean hip flexion and hip extension. All subjects of this study completed both foam rolling and rolling massage in 2 different days, and they were tested immediately following the intervention in passive hip flexion and extension range of motion, as well as 10, 20 and 30 minutes post-intervention. The results show that both foam roller and roller massages statistically increase range of motion in hips. In addition, foam roller seem to be superior in increasing range of motion compared to roller massager immediately and 30 minutes post-intervention. These findings point out a direct effect of foam rolling in range of motion. Similar results were found in a paper from 2015, where Jacob Scarabot and colleagues conducted research comparing the effects of static stretching, foam roller and a combination of both on ankle range of motion. This time, the participants were swimmers with experience in foam rolling and then completed one of the following interventions each day of the program. Static stretching and foam rolling interventions consisted by 3 sets of 30 seconds stretching and rolling respectively, whereas the combination of both consisted of the foam rolling intervention followed by the static stretching intervention. Passive ankle dorsiflexion range of motion was measured immediately post-interventions. The results show that all interventions led to acute increase in flexibility, while combination of foam rolling and static stretching appeared to have an additive effect in comparison to foam roller alone. In addition, the effects of all 3 interventions lasted less than 10 minutes, indicating that this increase in range of motion are not permanent. And there are many more studies that have found increase in range of motion after foam rolling, but since they are all included in the reviews that I will present you later on this video, I will only show you regarding range of motion one more study that came from Vygotsky and colleagues. This time, scientists conclude that it's unlikely that foam rolling will improve range of motion in passive hip extension and knee flexion, especially if performed in combination with a dynamic stretching protocol. The actual difference of this study was that instead of just foam rolling and then measuring the results, they conducted a 10-minute warm-up before. This warm-up consisted of 5 minutes on a bike, 2 sets of 20 bodyweight squats, 2 sets of 10 leg swings in both frontal and sagittal plane, and 2 sets of 10 bodyweight lunges. Afterwards, they did 2 sets of 60 seconds foam rolling and tested range of motion. So there might be no additional effect in range of motion when foam rolling is combined with the dynamic warm-up, but we need more data to determine this relationship. We'll see a lot more regarding range of motion on the reviews, but now let's have a look on some studies on recovery. A popular study by McDonald and colleagues had subjects perform 10 sets of 10 reps back squat and then receive either 20 minutes of foam rolling exercise or no treatment at all. They tested different variables regarding muscle soreness, range of motion and performance in 24, 48 and 72 hours post-exercise, and found that foam rolling reduced muscle soreness at all time points while substantially improved range of motion, vertical jump height and muscle activation. Similarly, a study from 2015 had subjects do the exact same intervention of 10 sets 10 reps back squat and again have either a foam roller intervention afterwards or no treatment at all. The actual difference was that they evaluated recovery with a present pain threshold method and also tested performance parameters such as 30-meter sprint, T-test, broad jump and strength endurance. The result was that foam rolling improved quadriceps muscle tenderness by a moderate to large amount in the days after fatigue, while substantial effects found also in sprint time, power and dynamic strength endurance. So foam rolling seems to reduce muscle soreness after strength training and by doing so improves indirectly performance. Same positive relationship of foam rolling and reduced soreness was found in a paper from 2017, where they tested perceived muscle soreness and performance variables 24 hours after training. A large effect on recovery and agility was found, as well as in perceived muscle soreness. and another study by Healy and colleagues in 2014 found positive correlation between foam rolling and a significantly less post-exercise fatigue. Still, there were contradict findings by a 2017 study where authors stated that neither muscle soreness nor range of motion were significantly impaired by foam rolling, although they did found that foam rolling expedited recovery of agility after training. In this study, subjects performed 40 sets of 50-meter sprints in order to produce delayed onset muscle soreness and then had either foam roller or no treatment. But the subject volunteers for this experiment were untrained with average BMI almost 27, which is classified as overweight. So having untrained overweight individuals perform 40 sprints, which is a great amount of workload even for trained athletes, and then ask them how they subjectively feel about their soreness, makes me don't want to put much stock in the study. I will summarize the data on recovery at the end of this video, but for now, let's take a closer look on the effects of foam rolling in performance. Starting from a study from 2013, where authors investigated the acute effects of foam rolling on knee extensor force and activation and knee joint range of motion. What they found was that although foam rolling increased range of motion, muscle force remained at the same levels. And this is one of the most important findings about foam rolling because it shows us that we can use it prior to training to increase range of motion without worrying about detrimental effects on performance, which has been shown to be the case with static stretching. And another very important study on performance came from Peacock and colleagues when they conducted research in order to determine if an acute bout of foam rolling in addition to a dynamic warm-up will be superior in improving performance compared to a dynamic warm-up alone. The control condition consisted of 5-minute standard warm-up followed by 5-minute dynamic warm-up, and the experimental condition had the same general and dynamic warm-up with the addition of a bout of total body foam roller. Measurement of muscle strength, speed and agility were taken after each condition. The data showed that combination of foam rolling and dynamic warm-up was superior in increasing all performance variables compared to dynamic warm-up alone. Range of motion remained at the same for both conditions, indicating once again that foam rolling might not have additional effects in range of motion when combined with dynamic warm-up. But again, in contrast to these findings, Monteiro and colleagues found in 2017 that when foam roller was applied on the interset rest periods of maximum effort knee extensions, it reduced the number of repetitions performed compared to a condition with passive rest. As you can see, most of the studies regarding performance have conflicting findings, and it's pretty clear that the direct effects of foam rolling on performance need further examination. So, in order to sum up the information and add some more, let's see some literature reviews on this topic. The first is from 2015, when 14 studies were analyzed and led to the conclusion that foam rolling appears to have short-term effects on increasing joint range of motion without hindering performance, and may help attenuate decrements in muscle performance and delayed onset muscle soreness after intense exercise. Short bouts of foam rolling prior to exercise do not appear to affect muscle performance. In the same year, Schroeder and colleagues analyzed two more studies and inferred that foam rolling appears to have a positive effect on range of motion and soreness following exercise, but further study is needed to define optimal parameters, that is timing and duration of use, to aid performance and recovery. And finally, Beardsley and colleagues analyzed in 2015 22 studies, with 6 additional studies to the aforementioned, and found that foam rolling increases flexibility and reduces muscle soreness, but does not impair athletic performance. And before I get to the conclusion of the data about recovery, performance and range of motion, here are some honorable mentions of scientific data found regarding foam rolling. A 2014 study investigated the acute effects of foam rolling on arterial stiffness and vascular endothelium function and found that foam rolling reduced arterial stiffness and improved vascular endothelium function. And this paper from 2016 explored the potential crossover effect of a foam rolling treatment on the ipsilateral limb on changes in the ipsilateral and contralateral ankle range of motion. Surprisingly, foam roller improved ankle range of motion for at least 20 minutes in the ipsilateral limb and up to 10 minutes on the contralateral limb, indicating that foam rolling produces a crossover effect into the contralateral limb. Both of these studies provide new and promising findings, but the data is very little and need further examination in order to take them into practice. And with these last studies, we got into the summary. Regarding range of motion, we saw that foam roller acutely increases range of motion without hindering performance. Also, the combination of static stretching and foam rolling provides greater range of motion when compared to foam rolling alone. And last, combination of foam rolling and dynamic warm-up might have no additive effect in range of motion. Regarding recovery, it's pretty clear that foam rolling after training reduces muscle soreness and improves tissue recovery. And last, we should split the effects of foam rolling on performance in two categories: the direct and the indirect effects. Directly, foam rolling doesn't impede performance, but the rest of the results are conflicting and need further examination. Indirectly, improved recovery allows participants to extend workout time and volume, which can lead to chronic performance enhancements. My personal suggestions to you are to use a quick total body foam rolling routine right on the beginning of your warm-up and spend from 10 to 30 seconds on every muscle group, with more time spent on the areas that are more tender. Foam rolling should not replace the dynamic warm-up, so I strongly recommend dynamic exercises right after foam rolling. And if you want to improve recovery, add a 5 to 10 minutes foam rolling routine at the end of your program or any time of the day after training, only on the muscle groups you have worked out. Make sure you spend from 40 to 60 seconds on each muscle group and try to repeat for at least 2 sets.